hidden among the majestic canyons of the Utah desert, about 7 miles from the nearest town, along a long dirt road, is a small research facility meant to prepare humans for life on Mars.
MDRS is the best analog astronaut environment. The terrain is extremely similar to the Mars terrain, and the protocols, research, science, and engineering that occurs here is very similar to what we would do if we were to travel to Mars.
CNBC was invited by the Mars Society, the nonprofit organization that runs the Mars Desert Research Station, to shadow one of its Mars analog crews and get a sense of what life on the red planet may one day be like.
Welcome to the Mars Desert Research Station here on Mars in Utah. And this is Crew 315. I'm Commander David Lottie. Come on in for a tour.
CNBC visited Crew Officer David Lottie and his team on the last day of their analog mission. The five-person crew spent 2 weeks living at the research station, following the same procedures that they would on Mars.
The most important part of our training is we learn how to thrive and survive while in an isolated, confined, and extreme environment. And being isolated for several weeks, you gain an incredible sense of what it would be like to be completely away from humanity.
This is the lower deck of the HAB, or habitat. It's a two-level building. The upper deck is a living area. The lower deck is where we keep our EVA suits.
Lottie and his team wear these suits whenever they go outside on EVA, or extravehicular activity missions, just like astronauts on Mars would need to do anytime they leave their pressurized station to step into the vacuum of space.
We have a computer station that can give us weather forecasts. We have sensors around the campus. And we have this cool little thing. We call it EVA Link. And on this map, when we are on EVA, we carry it. And the person back here can see exactly where we are on this map.
The first floor also houses a shower and bathroom.
So come on up to the upper deck of the HAB, and I'll show you where we spend most of our time living and sleeping, and the kitchen as well. We're on the upper deck of the habitat now. This is where we have our 6 bedrooms for 6 people. If we have a crew of more than 6, we have a loft area up here and another loft area up here. It's a more basic living arrangement, mostly just cushions.
Conveniently located next to the bedrooms is the kitchen.
I tell crews in advance that they be very surprised at the quality of the food they're going to get. And when they get here, they are, because we have quite a bit of ingredients that we can use. These are mostly standard dry foods, and then freeze-dried down here, a wide range of vegetables and fruits and some meats.
We have a bread-making machine. We've got other crew members that know how to cook. So it's been almost like a 5-star experience.
Most of the food will be freeze-dried because it's low weight and small area, and then it can be hydrated en route or once they get to Mars.
The station also houses its own garden to spice up crew members' freeze-dried diet.
We grow tomatoes and radishes and carrots and a bunch of different herbs, and it's meant to simulate what a crew would really do, since fresh food is necessary for enjoyment, but also to keep a group of people going on Mars.
The rest of the complex is made up of the RAM, or Repair, Maintenance, and Safety Building, and the Science Dome, where crew members run experiments. The covered tunnels connecting the buildings represent pressurized sections, where crew members don't have to wear spacesuits. Like on Mars, the station must be completely self-sufficient. Electricity is generated by large solar panels, though Lottie says that on Mars, dust storms and lower solar energy make small nuclear power generators a more reliable source of electricity. As is typical of real space missions, each crew member comes into MDRS with a specific job and experiment to perform. The engineer fixes problems as they come up, the greenhab officer is in charge of the garden, and the health and safety officer makes sure everyone is safe. They all work together to survive on Mars. And organization is key.
The day at the station, we all gather around by 7 a.m. around a common table in the upper deck, and we have breakfast. Around 8 o'clock, we have our first meeting of the day where we plan out the day. And then in the morning, we usually have an EVA of two or three people, and usually another one in the afternoon. The people that remain in the hab, they'll serve as communications with the EVA team, and they might have projects that they'll be working on while the EVA team is out.
The most challenging aspect of our mission were radio communications, where we struggled to keep in touch with Capcom. Our communications were experiencing extreme distortions and static, and it was really difficult to communicate smoothly.
I think the most challenging thing about these analog missions is just getting into a rhythm, finding time to do your project, to focus on hygiene, to make meals, to kind of document and journal what you're doing. And although here the risk is lower, on Mars, you know, performing those daily tasks are what keeps us alive.
Four of us are going to take two rovers and EVA to demonstrate a couple of our projects.
CNBC rode along with crew engineer Michael Andrews, who was testing two projects on this outing.
I'm taking a Starlink Mini and a mobile battery pack and bringing that on our EVAs to provide myself and other crew members the ability to send data back to our station or even to quote-unquote Earth. And then my second project is to take commercial off-the-shelf 3D scanners and take geological samples, essentially rocks that we find on our EVAs, and scan those to create digital twins that can then be used, theoretically, by geologists to analyze those samples without sending them back to Earth.
During our outing, Crew Commander David Lottie and Health and Safety Officer Urban Coy tested out drone technology for use on Mars. Drones could help astronauts explore larger areas of the planet.
We know that the helicopter Ingenuity has successfully flown on Mars, so we think drones can do the same. So I created a couple projects based on using drones. And the first one is just simply, what is the difference in flying the drone without an EVA suit on versus having an EVA suit on? And the results are pretty much what you would expect, that the visibility is not quite as good. Then there's a dexterity problem with the gloves, so handling the drone becomes a bit more difficult.
Back at the habitat, we asked the crew to reflect on their experience after spending 2 weeks living on a pretend Mars. Would they live on the red planet for real?
When I was a youngster, of course I would have wanted to go to Mars, but now I think the difficulties would be more than I want to bear. Being in a distant place without your usual community around you, without your usual conveniences. You're very restricted in what you have. You're very restricted in where you can go. You're very restricted if you do go outside. You have to have a very precise plan. But you know, we know this is going to end sometime, so knowing that makes everything go a lot easier.
My primary job here at the simulation is as an actual journalist. I work for Harper's Magazine and I'm writing a long reported story about this experience. So I think it's been interesting for me to think about what it would feel like if we were here for a really, really long time or forever. And I think just imagining that is almost impossible.
I definitely think about one day living on Mars, and this definitely does prepare me for that. If there was a seat on a rocket to Mars, I'd say sign me up, I'm ready to go.